Spanning over 5,000 acres, the Tide Flats is home to a waterfront providing vital saltwater and estuarine habitat for marine life, an economic center for industrial and manufacturing and a world-class port, and the ancestral lands of the Puyallup Tribe of Indians. The Tide Flats are a center of cultural, environmental, and industrial importance. Help us make a plan that centers all of the activities that the Tide Flats support to make it a stronger community asset for now and tomorrow. Learn more at cityoftacoma.org/Tide Flats.
Good evening. Thank you for joining us today for a discussion about the Tacoma Tide Flats and to hear more about this important project. I would like to note that there is closed captioning available if you are deaf or hard of hearing. And as you heard from Kenny previously, there is also Spanish interpretation. And if you push the interpretation button at the bottom of your screen, you will be able to join that room. The intent this evening is to share information about the Tide Flat subarea and the upcoming planning process. Also to give you background to participate in upcoming interactive visioning sessions, which will be happening in March. We'll also be introducing the five participating governments, which have really formed a model of collaboration on this project, which is demonstrated by this collective effort. You'll hear from welcomes from elected officials from all five of those jurisdictions this evening as well. Next slide. This is a land recognition statement that we work to develop with tribal staff. I would like to read it for the group this evening. Let us acknowledge that this project is being conducted on the historical and current homelands of the Puyallup Tribe of Indians. Since time immemorial, they have hunted, fished, and gathered in the Tacoma Tide Flats, and they retain these rights to this day. Let us take this moment to recognize the unique responsibility in being co-stewards with the tribe over these lands and waters, and work with them to safeguard their treaty-protected rights. So how to engage in this meeting? We hope you have a phone, smartphone, or second device available. And we will be doing some interactive exercises with Mentimeter. And so if you go to menti.com using the code you see at the top of this slide, you'll be able to participate in those exercises. Also during the Q&A session, if you can submit questions on Zoom, we'll be addressing those later by expanding on the frequently asked questions on the website. And if you need technical support, Rebecca@burkconsulting.com is standing by to give you assistance. So you can send an email directly to her. So now the first poll. I'm going to give you all a moment so that you can go to menti.com, again, using the code 6586146. Looks like we're having some success already. The question is, what is your connection to the Tide Flats? We've had a handful of respondents, more coming. I like how they come out of right field here. So we have, property owner, good. So we have someone representing every one of these categories. And it looks like many who either work or work in the area or live nearby. We'll find out more about other later on. And we have some business owners and property owners. So, excellent. One more coming. All right. A good sampling. I think everyone's got the system down now. The next question is, what is your home zip code? And this is a word cloud, so the ones that have more respondents will get larger. 98405 seems to be the popular one, the largest group of participants. I think we have a few more coming based on the prior one. So we've changed. So that gives you a sense of the distribution of who's in the room. Well, thank you for participating in those two little polls. There will be some other opportunities this evening as well, but it seems like many of you have access to the proper tool in order to respond. So thank you for doing that. Now we'd like to hear some welcoming remarks, opening remarks from the participating jurisdictions. And the first speaker tonight is City of Tacoma Mayor Victoria Woodards. She has served as an at-large member of the City Council for 7 years before becoming mayor in 2018. She has called Tacoma home for nearly her entire life and is a proud graduate of Tacoma's Lincoln High School. Mayor Woodards also currently serves in national leadership roles at the National League of Cities and U.S. Conference of Mayors. Mayor Woodards.
Good evening, and thank you, Marcia, so much for the introduction. And it's such an honor to be here this evening. I have to tell you, I'm so excited that this moment is finally here. And so delighted to see so many people, 78 people in the room right now, to talk about this very, very important issue to our city. You know, when I became mayor and we were talking about the sub-area plan and the tide flats, I said, okay, well, we're going to get this done and we're going to get everybody on the same page and we're all going to do this together. And although it's taken us a little while to do that, I am very delighted tonight that all five governments are here standing together talking about the future of the tide flats. We know that these governments and that this opportunity is going to respond to a myriad of priorities like the environment and job creation. And it's going to take all of those things together to make the tide flats what we want it to be. As we plan the future for this very important area, we are doing so because of the value of the collaboration and shared decision-making among the participating jurisdictions. I've been saying this statement that I'm gonna say in just a moment a lot lately because I think it really describes the importance of going together. And it says, if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. And sometimes in order to go together, it takes us a while to get there because you got to make sure that everybody is still with you as you move down the path. And I'm delighted tonight that we've gotten to this moment where we're still together and we're still moving forward. And now it's time for our community to weigh in and be a part of planning the future of the port. I want to thank Councilmember Lillian Hunter very quickly, who serves on this committee with me. I also see that Council Members Walker and Ushka are in the room tonight. And I just want to thank the entire City Council for making sure that while it took us a little bit longer, that we made sure that we all got here together because we all play an incredible role in the future of our Tide Flat. So grateful for all of you to being here this evening, excited to hear from all of our partners, but this is just the beginning. It's time to get moving and we're gonna do it together. Thank you all so much.
Thank you, Mayor Woodards. Next is Chairman Bill Sterud from the Puyallup Tribe of Indians. The chairman was first elected to the Tribal Council in 1978. Chairman Sterud has served on the Puyallup Tribal Council for more than 30 years and has held the role of chair and vice chair on several occasions. Currently, he is serving as the chair of the Tribal Council. Chairman Sterud.
All right, hello. Thank you all for joining us today. I'm Bill Sterud, chairman of the Puyallup Tribe of Indians. I welcome you all virtually to the Puyallup Reservation. The Puyallup Tribe of Indians have existed on these lands and waters since time immemorial. We hunt, fish, and gather in these lands and waters. We are excited to work towards a new sustainable vision for the Tide Flats, and Tribe looks forward to collaborating in this process. Today, we want to hear from you, but first, some of you might be wondering why the Tribe is participating in this plan. I want to take this time to express why I care so deeply about the Tide Flats and why we are here at the table. What happens in the Tide Flats is personal to me. I have lived in the Tide Flats my entire life. I have personally witnessed the growth and the decline of our lands. Our river and streams have been reduced to levees, ditches, and are restricted by poorly functioning culverts. Our tidelands are nearly all rocks and have little to no vegetation. Industrial stormwater pours into the headwaters where the river and the streams meet Commencement Bay. It is difficult for our salmon or other life to thrive in this system. It breaks my tribe's heart to see fish returning fewer in numbers each year. There are certainly more global issues to consider, but the localized impacts to fish are real, and we have a chance to address them in this plan. A world-class deep water port should also mean world-class green infrastructure and a world-class environment. They must coexist if we are to survive as a people. That is one of the main reasons we are participating. We need someone to speak for those who can't speak for themselves. The plants, fish, and the environment are not in the state they need to be. We are here to ensure that the price of progress does not kill the environment any longer. Did you know that there are naturally occurring oysters still in the tide flats? Oysters are an amazing tool to pull carbon and other harmful pollution out of the water. This work will require us to work together. The effects of climate change will greatly change how we think about the port and how businesses operate. We'll also determine how the tribe operates its lands as well. The tribe is invested with its own businesses in the tide flats and depend on them for jobs and income to provide services to our people. We are seeking new clean economic development opportunities and rely on the infrastructure to continue to support those investments. The impacts of climate change are not hypothetical. We need to work together to protect what we have. Otherwise, we may all lose this area. I do not mention this at all to discourage everyone, but we have our challenges before us. But I believe we have a great opportunity here to talk about our future. I hope you all think about how we can enhance this area to serve our communities. I am glad we are doing this planning in a good way. Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman Starrood. Next, we have Port of Tacoma Commissioner John McCarthy.
Good evening. Thank you. I am John McCarthy. I, along with Commissioner Don Meyer, are the two Port of Commission representatives serving on the Sub-Area Plan Steering Committee. Thank you very much for your interest in the Tide Flats, the Sub-Area Plan, and for attending tonight's kickoff meeting. I've been asked to talk briefly about the Port of Tacoma and why this process is important to you, to Pierce County, and to Washington State. As Pierce County's gateway to the global economy, the port is deeply invested in economic health, jobs, and the vitality and health, well-being of our community. We are able to successfully leverage private and public funds to build infrastructure, not only to sustain international trade and manufacturing, but to also grow jobs and strengthen our local tax base. Examples of this include the recently completed modernization of the Husky Container Terminal in the Tide Flats, which was a project completed through our partnership with the Port of Seattle through the Northwest Seaport Alliance. And another example of this job creation activity is the development of the Tyler Way Auto Processing Facility, who welcomed Volvo as a new customer last year. We, the Port of Tacoma and the Port of Seattle combined are the fourth largest gateway for products into the United States. And also we are a gateway to allow our agricultural products and other manufactured and products to be exported to other areas of the world. Industrial leases on the Tacoma Tide Flats and the movement of marine cargo managed by the Northwest Seaport Alliance through our facilities generates substantial support and over 29,000 jobs in Pierce County. With many businesses being closed due to COVID and people looking for employment, these jobs are even more critical as many of those positions are entry-level positions offering good wages and benefits. Many of these jobs can become lifelong careers. We're in the midst of a strategic planning process at the Port of Tacoma. And it was interesting to note in that process, we did some polling and heard a lot of comments from people who indicated by consensus of the stakeholders and constituents that the number one job they felt that the Port of Tacoma was to do was to retain and to continue to bring jobs to the South Sound. That's our primary focus, and develop jobs in the community so people can live and work in their community and not have to drive a long way up the I-5 corridor in order to work. So this economic activity means tax revenues as well that support our schools, our libraries, and social service programs. The port itself generates an estimated $225 million in state and local tax revenue every year for fire protection, libraries, and other services. Even with people staying at home during COVID, freight continues to move, delivering essential goods throughout our community. And they ultimately arrive on our front porches and the front porches throughout the United States by FedEx, UPS, and Amazon. We indeed are keeping our supply chain alive for all of us. I think it's important to note that the Port of Tacoma owns about one half of the 5,000 acres of the Tide Flats. And much of this land, particularly north of East 11th Street that you see today, and it was land that was underwater and reclaimed. The Port of Tacoma itself is a public port for public benefit, has been in existence for about 100 years. In addition, I want to point out that we've made significant contributions to improve legacy contaminated properties and lands in the Tide Flats, which were contaminated many years ago, and we've been able to return them to usable industrial lands. An example of this is the port's purchase and cleanup of the former Kaiser Smelter site. Today, after the port spent tons of money, and that parcel is now an active auto facility, bringing employment opportunities as well as state and local tax revenues. I previously mentioned our port's strategic plan process and people's desire that we improve our economic base. The number second priority that was clear to us is that the people in our community want us to be environmental stewards and to improve and correct any environmental issues that are involved in our properties. And we'll continue to be responsible stewards to these lands. In fact, just last week, the Port Commission approved the Wapato Creek Habitat Project. This is a pretty expensive, it's a $17 million mitigation project, which replaces two fish barrier culverts that convert Wapato Creek under 12th Street East with a single fish passable bridge, and also relocates Wapato Creek from a ditch system to a longer meandering stream channel and associated wetlands to provide an increase in the quantity and quality of fish and wildlife habitat, as well as additional flood capacity. And I want to recognize the Puyallup tribe and Chairman Sterud and the other members of the tribe who have in essence partnered with us, assisted us, consulted with us in making this a very valuable project that's also very important to the Puyallup tribal members. So I want to thank you very much once again. We thank you for your participation, and we look forward to hearing your comments and suggestions. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner McCarthy. And I also realized I failed to properly introduce you at the beginning. So I'd like to just say a couple of things now before we go on. And that is, Commissioner McCarthy is a retired Pierce County District and Superior Court judge, where he served for more than 22 years. He also served previously on the Port of Tacoma Commission and was most recently elected to the Port of Tacoma Commission in 2017. So now on to Pierce County, Executive Bruce Dammeyer. A Pierce County native, he graduated from Curtis High School, where he served eight years as a Civil Engineer Corps officer in the U.S. Naval Academy. At the conclusion of his military service, he returned to Washington State and dedicated his time to serving the community. He's been on the Puyallup School Board as a member between 2001 and 2009. He served in the State House of Representatives and the State Senate in 2009 to 2016. And in November 2016 was elected executive of Pierce County. So Executive Dammeyer. Oh, there you are on the left of my screen. Please, the floor
thank
is
you
yours.
Very much. Thank you very much, Marcia, for that introduction. And thank you all for participating tonight. As we all are keenly aware, and that great introductory video reminded us, these tide flats have been a special place forever, a special natural place, a special place of gathering, and they have been our connection to the broader world in all that time. And they remain all those things today. In a world that is dominated by global trade, the port housed in the tide flats is our connection to that. And today they remain a gathering place. In fact, they are an economic pillar for Pierce County and the broader region. This work that we're embarking on tonight and that you're going to help us with is important. The outcome is important and the process is important. I am proud to stand here representing Pierce County along with Councilmember Ryan Mello. And I see that Councilmember Hans Zeiger is participating tonight as well. But I'm proud to stand here representing Pierce County, shoulder to shoulder with the City of Tacoma, the City of Fife, the Port of Tacoma, and the Puyallup Tribe of Indians. We are committed to collaborate on this effort because getting the right outcome is important, but doing it in the right way is also important. And you are playing an important part of that outcome tonight. Thank you very much.
So I will unmute. Thank you, executive. Now we are going to hear from Council Member Ryan Mello. He has a strong commitment to local government, serving 10 years on the Tacoma City Council and 5 years on the Metro Parks Tacoma Board. And he's now serving on Pierce County Council, representing most of Tacoma, including the Tide Flats, Fircrest, and University. Ryan grew up in Hawaii and moved here to attend the University of Puget Sound and then fell in love with the people and places of the South Sound. Council Member Mello.
Marcia, I'm not sure Council Member Mello could join us tonight.
Aha. Well, you know all about him now. So in that case, thank you for that information. And we will move on to Council Member Lisa McClellan for the City of Fife. Lisa has served on the Fife City Council since 2017 and previously served on the Fife Planning Commission and Parks and Recreation Advisory Board. She's a third generation resident of Fife. Council Member McClellan.
Thank you so much and good evening. First off, I wanna thank everyone for participating in tonight's event. I can't stress enough how a successful sub-area plan for the Tide Flats will mean success not only for Fife businesses and residents, but for our community as a whole. Now I'm tempted to say Fife's top three concerns are transportation, traffic, and congestion, because we all know Fife is the worst. But what I see here is an opportunity for the common interests that all of our governments share. We want to protect family wage jobs, honor each government's rights, ensure we listen to all of our stakeholders, and building partnerships to solve transportation problems. Fife's tagline is industrious by nature. Industry is in Fife's DNA. It's in our history and it's in our future. This tagline means many things. It means we're innovative, and it means we're responsive to change. We're always looking for solutions in our community to respond to issues. The Port of Tacoma Tide Flats is a two-way gateway to the state, the nation, and the international economy. Fife serves as a gateway to that port. Together, we're on the cusp of even greater things, and we're looking forward to working together as we shape that future. We live in such a beautiful and important region, and this project will help shape the future of the South Sound. So thank you for having Fife on board, and we look forward.
Thank you very much for those closing words. Now we are going to hear from the project, from three of the project management team members who are going to provide more information about the project and also do some polls. And that group also includes representatives from all five jurisdictions, and you'll be hearing from others later when we get to the question section. So with that, I'm going to turn to Steve.
Great, and thank you, and it's fantastic to be here this evening. I'm Stephen Atkinson. I'm a principal planner with the City of Tacoma, and I'll be walking through the first few slides of the presentation. I will be covering some similar ground that our elected representatives and steering committee members have already, I think, covered in their statements. And I'll just admit here at the beginning, I will not do it as eloquently as they have done. But I think it's fitting to acknowledge as we start this process that we're not starting our visioning work and this planning process with a blank canvas. I think what we've heard tonight from the video to the statements from our steering committee members and elected representatives have really reflected the fact that the Tide Flats has a myriad of uses of environmental assets, cultural context. It's very broad, very historic. It's an area where we have almost 10,000 employees who are really supporting their livelihoods in the Port Tide Flats. We have critical fish and wildlife habitat, wetlands, a river channel, and salmon and shellfish populations that really rely on this area. As well as we've heard this evening, that it's the ancestral home for the Puyallup Tribe of Indians and provides a significant cultural context both for the tribe and the surrounding communities. So next slide, please. And as we start this conversation, I do want to, again, just point out that there are times when we talk about the tide flats versus the port, so there are times where we're talking about the port with a capital P and port with a lowercase p. So when we talk about the tide flats, we're generally talking about the whole deep water port that we know and that we're familiar with. But a significant portion of that area, as Commissioner McCarthy pointed out, is really directly related to the Port District. About half the land within the tide flats is owned and managed by the Port of Tacoma. The port was created in 1918 by a vote of the citizens of Pierce County. It's a countywide port district. And it's grown significantly since that time, from 240 acres of land in the tide flats to over 2,700 acres today. In 2015, the Port of Tacoma and Port of Seattle created the Northwest Seaport Alliance, creating a partnership between those two ports to help leverage our assets. And that Seaport Alliance is the second largest container gateway in the West Coast and fourth largest in the United States. Next slide, please. And we will just pause here for a moment to do another Mentimeter. So if you still have your phones handy, please use the code and join us again. Really interested in hearing kind of as we start on this journey, what one of your favorite features of the tide flats is. So if you can take a moment and share that information, that'd be fantastic. So what is your favorite feature in the tide flats? And I'll just say for myself, I'm not sure I can pick one. That's a hard ask, but we are asking you to share one, just one of your favorite features. And that's fantastic. We're seeing the, let's see, it's moving a lot, but the habitat sites, view of Mount Rainier, the native history, Port of Tacoma. And again, I think this is very illustrative of many of the same values, the multiple values that we find, the multiple benefits that we have in the Port of Tacoma today, and the way that impacts a variety of our community members in a different way. So I'll just give it a few more seconds here for folks to enter. And then when our slide host is ready, we'll move on. All right, fantastic. And if you haven't had a chance to enter your favorite feature yet, please still take the time to do that. Now, these next couple slides, I just want to take a few minutes to elaborate on kind of what a subarea plan is. So I think this is kind of a key question of just making sure that as we're starting this process, we have kind of a good baseline understanding of that. So there is sort of, I guess, two facets to this. On the one hand, a subarea plan is, it's a policy document, it's a capital planning document. It'll talk about actions that we're going to undertake in the near term to long term to try to improve or direct how growth and development happens within the Port Tide Flats. But I think the kind of the critical thing here is not as much the nuts and bolts of what a subarea plan is, but kind of what the impact of a subarea plan is. And so it's an opportunity through this process to really create kind of mutual understanding, really identify where we have mutual interests and supporting values, and how to leverage those as we move forward in this process. So part of the value of doing this process is creating those relationships, creating those shared interests, and unpeeling back some of that understanding that we have of where our community is coming from, where our governments are coming from, as well as other agencies and interested parties. So kind of that's where I think you'll hear a lot from staff about kind of where we're starting from in this process is really about building those relationships, building that trust, understanding some of the uniqueness of our perspectives, both among the governments and our community. And then the plan as we go through this is an opportunity to then from that kind of starting point, create a shared vision of what we want the port to become over the next decade. So the next 30 years, how is the port going to function? What is it going to be supporting? Who will be working there? How is it going to be able to sustain the salmon and the fisheries that we rely on in Commencement Bay and the Puyallup River. And then the plan itself, that document, is a way of sort of identifying and codifying in a way those commitments that we're making to each other, to our community over the coming decades. So the second piece of this I would just highlight is that a subarea plan is also a document that has some parameters and some guidelines that we have to follow. So as I mentioned earlier, our planning isn't a blank slate. We have an existing context in the tide flats. We also have some guideposts we have to follow in doing the planning work. So we have a layering of state policies, regional policies, and local policies that we're required to follow. And so you'll hear again from staff and from our elected representatives about the importance of maintaining the long-term employment within this area. And that's one of the core functions of the Port Tide Flats. You'll also hear about the mandates we have to ensure a healthy and sustainable environment. And so that kind of gets to the crux of this planning process, is how we're going to conduct that work in the coming decades. Next slide, please. The other, I guess, directive I think we've heard from our elected representatives on the steering committee is that through this process, like as we're building this have mutual understanding, the sense of shared responsibility, that we're also not going to shy away from some of the challenges that we're looking ahead. And so we know in the coming decades, climate change and sea level rise will pose some unique challenges in the tide flats. We want to maintain a thriving port, even as we're looking ahead and trying to understand what those vulnerabilities are and those impacts may be. And so what we're hearing is this marching orders as we go forward, that we're not going to shy away from hard conversations, hard policy choices. We're going to approach this work seeking win-win solutions, seeking kind of mutual benefit, and looking for these ways to kind of understand how we can meet the multiple potentials for this area. At the same time, we understand that there's going to be some complex challenges. We're not going to kind of shy away from those, as I said, and we'll be facing those head on. And we'll be looking to our community to help us identify both what those challenges are and how you think we can be tackling those challenges as we look ahead for the coming decades. And then next slide. And with that, I believe I'll be handing it off to our next speaker.
Steve, before you do that, I just wanted to acknowledge very quickly that Councilmember Ryan Mello has joined us this evening.
All right, so we'll take a pause here for a moment. And again, hopefully you still have your phones ready. We'll have a couple more of these polls as we go through the meeting. So what is one thing you hope stays the same in the tide flats over the coming decades? So again, we're thinking this planning effort is gonna be looking at a 30-year planning horizon. So over the next three decades, what is one thing you hope stays the same? All right, and we've got some responses coming in, and hopefully it looks like around 25 people have provided some responses. Hopefully we can get all 63 attendees who are in the room tonight to participate. And again, it's probably not a surprise, but jobs are very significant in people's responses here this evening, as well as habitat, protection of the environment. Certainly, I think seeing a lot of different themes really relating back to those core values and core benefits of the Port Tide Flats. All right, we're at 58 responses. So a few more.
Steve, I can't help but comment on the fact that the Mentimeter results are looking really similar to what I remember seeing in the strategic plan, similar questions that we had for the Port of Tacoma.
All right. Excellent. So as soon as we're ready to move on to the next slide.
Your dress up.
So the next question we have is, what is one thing you hope to change in the tide flats?
All All right, we've got about, I think about a third of our audience members that have responded, so please keep up the great work.
I think that looks pretty good. You think, Marcia, you want to go ahead and move to the next slide? And people, I guess it will still be open here on Menti for a while if people want to continue to add. Yes, my name is Deirdre Wilson, and I'm the senior planner for the Port of Tacoma. I also work for the Northwest Seaport Alliance, which is an organization that manages the cargo operations for the Port of Seattle and the Port of Tacoma. And I do want to recognize a comment that I happened to notice from someone who's attending the meeting that talked about, you know, we're all very excited to be here for this kickoff meeting. I'm one of the representative staff of one of the governments, and the five governments have been working, as Mayor Woodard's alluded to, for quite some time in trying to kick this process off. But I do want to recognize that the community has been working with us as we prepare for this kickoff meeting. So thank you for continuing to participate and be interested in this important topic. What are the themes of the intergovernmental partnership and planning process? Well, the work plan that we have that was approved by the five governments lists out specifically on the first page of that document that it's to be economic prosperity for all, environmental remediation and protection, transportation and capital facilities planning, and why we're here today, public participation and outreach. These topics will also guide our visioning sessions that we'll be sharing information about later in the meeting that will be upcoming opportunities for the public to be able to participate more in this process. Next slide, please. So the other thing that we worked on in the work plan, which like I said, was the five governments working together, two elected representatives, as well as many staff from the different governments. In the work plan, we thought about what do we want to see in that final plan that we have for the Tide Flats subarea. The Tacoma City Council will adopt the subarea plan as an element of the city's comprehensive plan, as they have done with other subarea plans that they've created throughout the city. The Tide Flats is a bit of a different subarea, as it's mostly industrial, which is a bit different than other plans that the city has undertaken and has added to the comprehensive plan. And that explains partly why there is this unique situation where we have the five governments working together on the subarea plan, and it's taking a bit longer for us to get to this point. And in the work plan that was approved a couple of years ago by the governments together, we set forth potential chapters for the subarea plan. And those would include a vision, the environment, land use, economy, public services and facilities, transportation, and then of course, a section on implementation actions so that we actually can see the results of our planning efforts that we put up so far. Next slide, please. So as far as what rules could this project affect? Well, it does become a part of the city's comprehensive plan, which is a policy document that guides the regulations that implement those policies. So the City of Tacoma Land Use Regulatory Code includes the actual rules that people have to follow when they develop their property, such as what uses are allowed, what the setback for buildings would be, how many parking spaces they need to have, how much landscaping they need to have surrounding the property, and also the environmental rules as far as what they may have to do to mitigate the impacts of their project. Then we also have the Shoreline Master Program, which applies to all of the shoreline areas within the city, including the Tide Flats. And so you can imagine that this is a significant issue for the Tide Flats, being a water body that has industrial uses, which are allowed by the Shoreline Master Program. But we do have to go through the process of amending that document anytime we do any changes to uses allowed along the shoreline, including that of the Tide Flats. Next slide, please. And I think that and the next speaker is taking over here.
Thank you, Deirdre. That's me. Hello, everybody. My name is Andrew Strobel. I'm the Director of Planning and Land Use for the Puyallup Tribe of Indians. I'm also one of the project managers working on the plan. I will be primarily speaking tonight about community engagement. And I just want to take this opportunity as well is to let folks know that the tribe has been very engaged in this process, and frequently there are questions of how the tribe is being consulted or involved in this process. And I just wanted to take that opportunity to say that we are very engaged in this process. As part of the process though, we have identified several different activities for public involvement, is why we've established these community engagement principles to provide good expectations of this project and when you can get involved and where. The project will provide regular and clear communication so you know when events are happening and how information can be found. As a footnote, much of this information can be on the city's website, where there is a project-specific website for the Tide Flats Sub-Area Plan. You can see it at the upcoming events. You can sign up on the city email list, and you can see all the important materials related to the project. I'll say more about this ahead. We plan to engage diverse perspectives to include those who have been historically marginalized or excluded through upcoming events, upcoming focus group sessions and panels. We are working to connect with those communities now. Based off of feedback we get here today and in future public engagement events, we plan on focusing on the specific issues brought up by the public and providing opportunities for the public to participate and influence how these issues are looked at. This is not just a boilerplate process by any means. Your input is huge to the plan development. The last two principles are short but important. Not everyone will likely be part of every event, and so there are going to be several opportunities along the way to provide for different input at different events and in different ways. Likely, many public events are going to be limited by COVID-19. This event is showing how we're adapting to that, but we are definitely planning to make these as accessible as possible. Slide. For reference, this is where we are at in the process, where the STAR is at. I know it's taken some time for us to get to this point, but you can see the core actions necessary for developing the plan. This is our general timeline of how we're going to execute the plan. Slide. I know I mentioned several engagement events that are on, several engagement events here. And for one of those is that we're exploring community visioning events at the following times, Wednesday, March 17th, Thursday, March 18th, Saturday, March 20th. We are also going to have an online survey. We are putting the tools together for meetings in a box. These are meetings where we have materials and handouts for folks to study and read to provide input. And finally, we plan on conducting a community meeting to provide the findings of all the visioning work to be determined. Slide. This question is, how can I stay informed and involved? We are going to continue to conduct our regular Tide Flats Steering Committee and Tide Flats Advisory Group meetings. The Steering Committee is composed of the perspectives of the five governments involved in the plan, and the Tide Flats Advisory Group is composed of key stakeholders. We have the scheduled visioning sessions and a location for where you can send your comments at. And that email address is tacomatideflats@cityoftacoma.org. Notifications on the city listserv on the city website. Search for Tide Flats Sub-Area Plan on the website, or what I've done is I've been able to Google it. Searching Tide Flats Sub-Area Plan should be one of the first things that pop up on your screen. Slide. And that should be for the next speaker, Marcy.
Yes. We have 9 questions that have come up frequently, and we are going to ask the members of the project management team to respond to those individually. We ask that you also put your questions in the Q&A function on Zoom. We're not going to take them this evening, but we will take those that are commonly asked questions and make sure that we have those added on the webpage. So you will see responses to those. So the first question I'm going to ask is, who will be making decisions on the final plan? And I'm going to direct that to Steve Frittle from the City of Fife.
Well, thank you, Marcy. Great question. Stick with me through 4 quick points to answer that question. You know, first, the intent of the subarea planning is to establish a shared long-term vision for a coordinated approach to development, environmental protection, and capital investments in the tide flats. Second, to accomplish this, the subarea plan will be prepared through a shared decision-making process that includes the 5 participating governments. Now, the structure for the shared decision-making through that 5 government steering committee, that committee is made up of representatives that welcomed us here tonight. The steering committee is composed of 2 elected officials from each participating government, and they provide general oversight and planning processes and guidance on policy decisions. The intent is to facilitate a mutual understanding and closer alignment of interest across all the jurisdictions. The steering committee will be the ones to make a final subarea plan proposal to the Tacoma Planning Commission and to the Tacoma City Council. Third, the Tacoma Planning Commission will make recommendations on the subarea plan, and the Tacoma City Council will make the final decisions. And one final point that Deidre and Andrew already spoke to, this work plan also provides significant public outreach, engagements, and opportunity. So I think we're all involved in this decision process. With that, Marcy, I turn it back over to you.
Thank you, Steve. How will public input inform the planning process and decisions? I'm going to turn that back to Andrew.
Thanks, Marcy. Going back to the slideshow where we presented where there are going to be several events where the public will be able to participate, they're going to focus on topic areas, expertise in different communities. These include the upcoming community visioning process, an online survey, and meetings in a box opportunities. Other important meetings down the road in the development of the plan will be showing the findings of the community visioning and public input related to the draft plan and the EIS early next year. As far as how public input will inform the plan, public input is going to be provided at the various decision-making legislative processes of the plan, watching Tide Flats Advisory Group and Steering Committee meetings, and so forth. The city will also have opportunities to speak at the Planning Commission and the City Council. We as staff will be incorporating that feedback into the plan, bringing decision points to the different parts of the legislative process. And sometimes, like in all planning efforts, input will conflict with others' input, and those will likely be issues brought before the legislative process in the city to resolve.
Thank you, Andrew. The next question is, how does this plan work with the plans of other participating governments? And I'm going to ask Steve Atkinson to start this particular response, but would be happy to hear from others as well on the project management team. So Steve.
Yeah, certainly, and happy to start us off here. I think when we think about this question, I think it's important again to just recognize that, you know, we as a city, all of our governments probably have a number of other planning efforts that are ongoing, and that could be capital planning or project level planning. We have a wide variety of departments and areas of expertise. They're engaged in sort of their department and their division missions. I think this opportunity really gives us a chance to try to leverage and better align all of these different plans and processes that are ongoing. So the city of Tacoma, just for example, we are currently engaging in a climate mitigation, climate adaptation planning. We're gonna have our own comprehensive plan updates coming up in just the next few years, as well as a number of other significant efforts. Our environmental services department is also developing watershed plans to manage stormwater and improve water quality throughout the city. And so again, I think this is an opportunity to really identify those areas where we have shared goals, not just among our governments and our community members, but even within the different departments and divisions and work groups within the city and each of our governments. And part of that effort is to really try to make sure that when there are strategic opportunities that we're really leveraging as many of our resources as we can to achieve these multiple goals. So those are just a couple of the projects I would highlight, but there's certainly a lot else happening at the city.
Are there others that would like to add to that from the project management team?
Hey, Marcy, let's go with the other Steve.
The other Steve, there you go.
The other Steve. You know, Fife shares our northern city limit with the city of Tacoma and the port. And so depending on how this plan works out, we may need to respond and address our own land use plan as we make our way through this process. And also, as Councilmember McClellan introduced, you know, we're really interested in reaching agreement over transportation and priority of projects. So we see our transportation plan being affected. And of course, that leads to changing our capital facility plan and our budgeting, along with many of those other issues that the first Steve mentioned. That's it for me, Marcy.
Great, thanks, Steve.
Yeah, so I can speak up on behalf of the Port of Tacoma just quickly. As Commissioner McCarthy mentioned, we're updating our strategic plan right now. And I think that one of the key things here is that the port is a countywide district. And so the scale of our focus for the strategic plan is countywide, not just focused on the tide flats. But when we look at our capital investments plan, we're looking at that 2,500 acres, half of the tide flats property that we own, as far as improvements for our facilities, as well as our interest in access to roads that may go through Fife and through the city of Tacoma and have statewide interest. So this planning effort focuses on the tide flats portion of the county. And so that will help us, further the goals of our strategic plan in order to implement, those strategies we have for keeping the container port element of our comprehensive plan strong. And so that we have, the transportation systems and the environment that we need to keep those programs that we have that Commissioner McCarthy spoke to earlier in place and to kind of weave all of this together. And so that's, the port has been very supportive and had a strong interest in being a part of this project for those reasons.
Good. Thank you, Deirdre.
I'll jump in.
All right, Andrew.
So for the tribe, we are a major landowner in the Tide Flats. And so a lot of our properties rely on TPU, Port of Tacoma, City of Tacoma infrastructure. And so a lot of the tribe's future economic development plans, plans for mitigation, fisheries mitigation and other types of environmental mitigation are really interwoven here because the tribe's lands are sort of checkerboarded throughout the tide flats. And we really rely on our local partners to work together so that even tribal projects can be successful. And so as part of that as well, the tribe is undertaking a comprehensive planning effort itself for how it will envision its land use. And, that's largely an effort relying on local utilities that are provided and synergizing with the local land use of the area. One of the things I like to highlight that, these are the original homelands of the tribe. And this is a federally designated reservation designated by the federal government. And this land is supposed to serve the benefit of the Puyallup people in many different ways. And we may have some disagreements with some aspects of land use, but it's our hope to work together so that we can identify those issues so that ultimately we're working together about how we're visioning this area.
Thank you, Andrew. Sean, did you have something?
I do. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Marcy. Sean Gaffney with Pierce County. I would echo my friends at Fife and, of course, the Port of Tacoma. Pierce County's at the table. Not that we have capital projects per se within the boundaries, it's a peripheral association with our transportation links. We're working on a Canyon Road North extension to the SR 167. There's also interest in public access and, of course, compatibility of land use. So we are at the table for when we update our comprehensive plan within the next 2 years and the abutting community plans, that we have been at the table. We can take that information and align it with the planning documents that are in place in Pierce County. So as things go down in the I-5 corridor and through the valley, it ripples through the entire county, and that is why we're at the table.
Great, thank you. So what follow-up or feedback can one expect from the input that's being given from the public, and when would that happen? And I'm gonna toss that back to you, Sean.
Sure, no problem. So my answer would be for feedback, when you could expect your input to be addressed and when. It's going to be continuous and ongoing. And what I mean that by that is we will grow out our frequently asked questions list, our FAQ, based on the questions coming in and out. We'll respond to projects throughout every phase of this development of the plan and update our FAQ as we move through. The beauty of an FAQ is you'll have 100 questions come in, and you can bet there's going to be a lot of overlap. So one well-answered question could take care of the inquiries of many. So we will take everything that comes in through the chats and the questions. We're going to log those in, and we'll be updating our webpage and the frequently asked questions to hopefully keep updated information. And if that will be accumulated through the development of the plan and as we move through each phase, and then passed on to those who will be making decisions, that being the steering committee, ultimately onto the Tacoma Planning Commission and the Tacoma City Council.
Excellent. Thank you, Sean.
Yep.
So how does this plan interact with the interim regulations? And I'm going to send this one to Steve Atkinson.
Yeah, great. Thank you for that question. And hopefully many of our audience members tonight, I'm sure, are familiar with the tide flats interim regulations, but some members here tonight may not be. So just to kind of give a little bit of background on what they are. In 2017, when the city was really kind of initiating the tide flat subarea planning process, we adopted a resolution kind of funding our portion and also kind of inviting and starting this collaborative process that we're engaged in today. As part of that, Tacoma City Council had asked the Planning Commission to consider whether or not interim regulations were warranted while we were going through the subarea planning process. And in general, interim regulations are a tool that are used on occasion when you're undertaking a pretty significant policy or regulatory process to really try to put a pause on certain kinds of developments. But as you're trying to make decisions about what the long-term vision and future is for an area, you're not also permitting significant new projects at the same time. So we went through that process in 2017. They were adopted by the City Council. They generally just address subject matter related permit notification, some immediate pause on development of non-industrial uses in the port tide flats, some pause on residential development to prevent encroachment of new residential uses in Northeast Tacoma, and then likewise some pause on certain types of industrial uses within the port tide flats as well and citywide. There has been some recent news so that we have been asked now with the Planning Commission to conduct a review of those interim regulations and bring back some new recommendations to the City Council. So if there are any questions on that process, people can feel free to reach out to me directly for more information. I can share, I think one of the key distinctions between these two is the interim regulation conversation is really about how we implement our existing policies in our land use regulations and zoning code. Whereas the subarea plan is really focused on looking ahead over the next 30 years, what do we want this area to become? What are our goals for this? And then how do we really reorient our policies, our codes, our programs to try to achieve that vision that we're setting forth? So they are to some extent sort of very different questions that are before us, but certainly some overlap in the processes. So happy to, again, answer any questions you may have about that.
Thank you, Steve. So how will this plan be used, and can it help us plan for a sustainable and economically rich future? I'm gonna send this one over to Andrew.
Thanks. good question. This plan is going to include visioning statements, which will determine policy direction essentially. And different implementation actions to achieve a vision of what we want to see in the tide flats. It's at least a 20-year plan, so there's going to be future implementation measures that will likely be adopted by the City Council to continue to meet the goals of the plan. The plan can be used as a vehicle for coordination between the participating governments to invest in infrastructure, like Steve had mentioned, environmental mitigation and other investments that we identify throughout the process. The plan has some core tenets like economic prosperity for all, environmental remediation and protection, coordinated transportation, and capital facilities planning. What the plan is studying are several elements that will provide for the vision of the plan, largely preservation of the city's industrial land base and economic role for the manufacturing industrial center. And based on some future projections for job growth, this will be part of the narrative for an economically rich future. Also, there'll be an area that will be studied for air quality, water quality, fisheries, and other species habitat. Climate change is a huge component of this plan, and that will lead to other study of other environmental characteristics. The plan definitely factors in the sustainable environmental elements necessary for this type of planning effort. The plan will provide opportunities to get grants and show that a needs assessment for what investments need to happen in the tide flats at a local, state, and federal level, and really bringing the different partners together to identify those priorities so that they get funded and we protect this, this important asset that we all cherish.
Great. Thank you, Andrew. How will possible risks and negative consequences of the plan be assessed? And I'm going to ask Deirdre to respond to this question.
Sorry about that. So the potential negative consequences and risks will be considered through the environmental review process. The environmental review process will look at potential impacts of future alternatives and measures to address those potential impacts. The environmental review process includes not only the natural resources, such as the air and water quality issues that Andrew just mentioned, but also transportation. This review allows the plan, the subarea plan, to be responsive to potential direct, indirect, and cumulative impacts and suggest ways to mitigate those potential impacts. We will have, our plan is in early 2022 to have a draft environmental impact statement available for public input. And one of the things I would like to point out in the environmental impact analysis, as I mentioned, there are alternatives that are considered, and an alternative might be status quo, do nothing, keep things the way they are. It might be focus on a certain type of uses, and then it might be let's focus on that certain type of uses, but do it at a certain scale potentially. And so, as I mentioned earlier, the difference between this subarea plan and other subarea plans in the city of Tacoma is that the tide flats encompasses the port of Tacoma and a manufacturing industrial center. that we refer to as a MIC, which was referred to earlier in one of Stephen's slides. The Manufacturing Industrial Center is a regionally recognized designation that is not something that is questioned through the sub-area planning process. That's something that's integrated as one of the assumptions that we are working within a manufacturing industrial center for this sub-area plan.
Thank you, Deirdre. Is the Northeast Tacoma Buffer Zone application being considered in the Tide Flats sub-area plan? And I believe that's a good question for Steve Atkinson.
Yeah, I see a theme here, getting a lot of very Tacoma specific questions. Mm-hmm. No, but I appreciate you bringing this up, because I think sometimes, over the years, it can be just recognizing, it's been a long time since 2017. And I think we all kind of recognize that. And it can be easy, I think, to kind of forget, how much process and conversation we've already had on these topics over the years. So just for some context for this question for audience members, one of the ways, it's pretty common, Tacoma does this, other jurisdictions as well, but one of the ways that community members can often participate in our long-range planning is by directly applying for a comprehensive plan or zoning code amendments. And so we, every couple of years, go through a process. We have open applications for folks to in our community to think about and apply for changes. And in 2017, the Northeast Tacoma Neighborhood Council had applied for some area-wide zoning changes along Marine View Drive with the intent of trying to look at the opportunity to create a transition area along that area, recognizing that we have some tensions in Northeast Tacoma as we have residential development and significant industrial activity in that part of our city. That was an application that we had accepted. And then as part of that resolution that council adopted starting the sub-area planning process, the council kind of gave direction to staff to basically incorporate that application and the specifics that were proposed by the Northeast Tacoma Neighborhood Council into our scope of work. And so that's something that we've not forgotten. We have that direction from our city council, and that we've been considering that as part of the scope for this process since the beginning. So we do know as we get into kind of the visioning process and alternatives development for the planning, that those are conversations that we'll be having about how to incorporate that and represent those specific proposals in that process.
Great. Thank you, Steve. How long will it take to complete the Tide Flats sub-area plan? This has been a long process. So Sean, I am going to ask you to respond to that.
Sure, the million-dollar question. So as Deirdre just mentioned earlier, the goal is to complete the draft sub-area plan and the environmental impact work by the end of 2022. So we're looking at 22 months from today to get that out. Once that's done, the steering committee, which is comprised of all the elected officials from the various jurisdictions, will provide the City of Tacoma Planning Commission with a recommendation on that draft sub-area plan. At that point, the legislative process for approval of the comprehensive plan will begin, and that is the City of Tacoma Planning Commission, as I stated, as well as the City of Tacoma's Council taking final action. This legislative process, so once it's handed off to the City of Tacoma, it's not unusual, having been in big projects like this and others of this scale, it could take up to an additional year once that transmission goes to the Planning Commission. So, I mean, we're looking at, you're getting close to three years to get out the other side. It could be less, it could be more, but that's what we're shooting for today with our best intent and goals in mind.
Great.
If I could just interrupt here really quickly, I think we're at the end of our question and answer, Marcy. And yes, we did have a late arriving elected leader who's been a part of this project since the 2017 and earlier date. If Council Member Ryan Mello would like to speak, I think he missed his opportunity earlier.
I think that would be excellent. And I did your introduction already, Council Member Mello. So if you would like to say a few words, please take this opportunity.
Well, thanks for that, Marcy. Thanks, Deidre. It's good to see everybody. For those that don't know, I'm Ryan Mello. And while I used to serve on the Tacoma City Council and helped start this good process years ago in 2017, as Mr. Atkinson indicated, I have a new role at the Pierce County Council. So I'm very honored to represent the people of Pierce County. I represent District 4, which does represent the tide flats of Tacoma. Downtown Stadium District, Hilltop, Central Tacoma, South Tacoma, and all of Fir Crescent University Place. So, you know, it's been said by many others, we're here to support the city of Tacoma in their planning process. We all know the tide flats are home to many jobs and just an indispensable resource for our environment, our community, our economy. So we look forward to supporting the city of Tacoma in their really important efforts in protecting this for all those reasons. So we'll be here to do that, and you can count on me to engage fully. So thank you so much.
Thank you, and thank you for your longtime participation in this effort. As mentioned, the additional questions that were put in the chat will take the typical questions and ones that seem of particular note that people are concerned about or interested in, and see that those get added to the FAQ on the website. We now have two very quick polls that we would like to do. So important, what's the best way to keep you informed? It is helpful for us to have feedback so that we can tailor what we're doing to make sure we give you the best opportunity to participate. Going to give it a few minutes here, or a couple minutes anyway. We're about almost a third of our emails. People definitely, virtual meetings work. Good. We've been working with the communications group for all five participating governments so that we can tap into those email lists for many folks. So again, it's good to know that that is an avenue that reaches folks. So this is a short demographic polling. It's four questions about race and ethnicity, age, disability status, and household income. So if you are willing to take this short survey, that is helpful information to us just to know what our reach is in having people participate in this particular process. And we will leave that open for a moment, and I just want to say thank you to all of you who participated this evening. It looks like we had 73 participants, and we hope that you will, in fact, continue to participate in events and keep giving us your feedback and thoughts and ideas about this important planning process. Also want to thank our presenters tonight and the elected officials who participated in the meeting. So with that, thank you for your time this evening, and we are truly finishing on time. So thank you.